I'm back in my house today. Tomorrow also here, then back to Cuttack. So, okay, we were still left to talk about Mana Singh. Who has read Mana Singh? What are the facts? Anyone? Hello. Anyone in the class present?
Yes, ma'am. Good morning.
Good morning, Mama Shakib. I'm asking a question, and has anyone read Mana Singh, and what are the facts of that case? If no one has read, then we take the case to have been read and discussed in the class, and everybody has understood it. I had mentioned to you the basic principle in the case was that if there is a joint liability charge and all others have been acquitted, then the charge by reference to joint liability cannot stand. So, if the charge is that somebody has, or this man has committed the offense in the presence of two others, but those two others are not identified, they were never arrested, they were never prosecuted, even then the charge can stand. But you said that the A, B, and C committed the offense by reference to joint liability, and A and C have been acquitted. B in such case cannot be held liable by reference to joint liability. So, if it was an unlawful assembly constituting of A, B, C, D, E, and A, B, C, D have been A, B, C, D have been acquitted, then E alone cannot be held liable by reference to unlawful assembly and group liability. So, if it was that no, there were five people, we do not know, there were 10 people. So we have identified five, but there are other five who were also involved. 10 people had come for dacoity. So five we could see, five we have not been able to identify. They were never arrested, not prosecuted. So if four of these are acquitted, one of them has been convicted by reference to 149, that can still hold because there are still said to be there are five more people. There is even one more people. So as long as there are unidentified other people, the liability for joint liability may come. But if it has the case of the prosecution is that these identified two or three or five are the only ones who were involved in the offense, and if all others have been acquitted, then naturally, single person cannot be held liable by reference to joint liability principle. So with that, we are ready to move to the next area of discussion, which is attempt. And we need to read the section of attempt, section 511. So please, somebody read that section.
May I?
Yes, please.
पनिशमेंट फॉर अटेम्प्टिंग टू कमिट ऑफेंसेस पनिशेबल विद इम्प्रिजनमेंट फॉर लाइफ और अदर इम्प्रिजनमेंट हुएवर अटेम्प्ट्स टू कमिट एन ऑफेंस पनिशेबल बाय दिस कोड विद इम्प्रिजनमेंट फॉर लाइफ और इम्प्रिजनमेंट or to cause such an offense to be committed and in such an attempt does any act towards the commission of the offense shall where no express provision is made by this code for the punishment of such attempt be punished with imprisonment for any description provided for the offense for a term which may extend to one half of the imprisonment for life or as the case may be one half of the longest term of imprisonment provided for that offense or with such fine as is provided for the offense or with both.
So, okay, this is laying down the principle that if no provision has been made for attempt, then 511 applies. But now read 307. Attempt to commit murder. Can you read? You found 307?
Whoever.
Yeah.
Okay. Attempt to murder. Whoever does any act with such intention or knowledge and under such circumstances that if he by that act caused death, he would be guilty of murder, shall be punished with imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 10 years and shall be liable to fine and if hurt is caused to any person by such act, the offender shall be liable to either imprisonment for life or to such punishment as is herein before mentioned.
So, okay, now we have got two sections. So, we have a specific section. So when you look at the scheme of the legislation, you will find three kinds of sections. One section which says murder, one section, a separate section which says attempt to commit murder. Then we have other sections. I don't have the IPC here. So then there are other series of sections in which the offense as well as attempt has been dealt with in the same section. Then we have this residuary clause in 511, which says that if there is no provision made for punishment of attempt to commit that offense, then this section will apply. So in cases of attempt to commit murder, the procedure, the test will have to be followed as given in 307. If there is an offense for which no punishment has been provided for attempt, then 511 will apply. At this point of time, we are not concerned with what is the quantum of punishment provided for this offense. What we are concerned with is, first, the principle that there are three situations in which attempt may be punished. One is a situation where there is an independent section providing for the attempt of that offense. Second one, where the same section provides for attempt as well as for commission. And the third one, which says for all the residuary categories. Now, when you compare the language of 307 and 511, you'll find there's a slight difference in the expressions used. So therefore, in Om Prakash, the controversy has been raised and to set it aside, that whether there may be some cases in which 307, it is a case of attempt to commit murder, but is not covered under 307, whether that will then fall in under 511. We'll come to that controversy a little later, but we need to be aware that this is how the lawyers do this whole litigation argument building. At one point of time, it was proposed that 307 scope is different, scope of 511 is different, so there might be certain circumstances where it is attempt to commit murder, but it will not be punished under 307, but punished under 511. So first of all, we need to recall ourselves that in all cases of offense, we said there are stages in the commission of the offense. So what is the first stage? You see that there's an intention formed to commit an offense. Then you have to do the preparation for commission of that offense. Then you need to do the action required for the offense. And if it results into the desired consequence, then offense is committed. If the desired consequence doesn't happen, the action taken towards commission of the offense then amounts to attempt. So suppose a person with the intention to commit theft goes to somebody's house and he is opening the lock of the locked house. So he is caught at the stage where he has opened the bolt but still not entered the house, has still not done anything more than having forcibly opened the lock of the house. Now, at what stage is this? For commission of theft, what is required is that he must move certain property. You still not reach that stage yet. So in this case, it will be a case of attempt because this was one of the series of acts towards commission of the offense. So it is not only that he has to actually move the property. If he has done something required from that, or suppose he has started moving the property. He has started putting them into a sack and he has just put them into the sack. He has still not taken them out of the house. He's caught at that stage. He's still at the stage of preparation, or has he committed the offense? Towards commission of offense, but the offense is not complete because unless he moves it out of the possession, the offense is not complete. But he has certainly started doing an act towards the commission of the offense. So at the earlier stage where he was caught at the stage of opening the door, he has still not entered the house. It will not be, I was a little confused in them myself. It will not be attempt to commit theft. It will be housebreaking. Because at that point of time, he has tried to break into the house. So it will be attempt to break into the house because he has still not entered the house. The moment he's entered the house, the outbreaking is complete. So therefore, we'll have to look at that what is the act which constitute an act towards commission of the offense. So when he's opening the door, he's still at the stage of preparation. So the preparation stage may be different one. No, he's procuring the tools for breaking the lock. Then he comes to the door and he starts breaking the door. It is still preparation when it comes to the offense of theft, because he has still not done an act which is required for the commission of the offense. So the difference in the language between 511 and 307 has been that in case of 511, the words used are does an act towards the commission of the offense. So any act towards the commission of offense constitute the offense of attempt under 511. What is the language used in 307?
Attempt for murder.
No. It says he does that act. The act here is, it does not say does an act towards commission of murder. It says, does an act under such circumstances that if by that act caused death, he would be guilty of the murder. So whether it is the penultimate, the last act which he was required of. So suppose I have taken out a gun and I'm aiming at the person concerned. I've still not pulled the trigger. Whether I'm liable for attempt to commit murder. Well, by aiming at the person, I would not be causing death. But if I look at 511, then aiming is an act towards commission of the offense, because without aiming you for fire, you're not going to get your results. So therefore, if you look technically at the language of 511, it will be an act toward commission of the offense. But if you look at the language of 307, by this act he cannot commit the death. He cannot cause the death. So therefore, at one point of time, the argument was that he must have done the last act required of him in order to commit an offense. And there was a lot of confusion on that front. So that has now been set aside, and it has been, and so therefore the argument was that if this is an act which is not covered under 307, that will still fall under 511, because for this kind of attempt to murder, there will be no, 307 will not apply. The other argument was that if a provision has been made, then that is the only provision under which attempt to commit murder will be punishable. So if anything falls out of this section, then that is not to be considered as attempt to commit murder. I think it's a little too early for us to understand the nuance of this one. So we'll just hold on to that, that there was this argument. So what we have learned in 511 is very clear, that as long as it is an act towards the commission of the offense. So now let's look at the illustration of 511. What does that say? Illustration A. Read, please.
Illustration A. A makes an attempt to steal some jewels by breaking open a box and finds after so opening the box that there is no jewel in it. He has done an act towards the commission of theft and therefore is guilty under this section.
So it may seem like that if there is no jewel there, then it is not possible to commit that offense. And there has been again series of cases which said that if it was an impossible attempt. So, but our legislation categorically says, you know, there is no jewels. Look at the second one also, makes an attempt to pick the pocket, but thrusting his hand into the Z's pocket. But he failed because there was nothing in the pocket. In both these scenarios, where the thing which was required to be the subject matter of the offense is not there, but I have done the act what is required of me. So I did not succeed because the thing attempted wasn't there, not because I was lacking in any action by myself. So the whole question is that in such cases, our legislation very categorically says we are liable, that the person making it liable. And there has been a stage where it was said that if it is not possible to commit the offense, now compared to this one, we need to look at Asghar Ali Pradhania. So in Asghar Ali Pradhania, what are the facts? What are the facts in Asghar Ali Pradhania? And how are those facts, Hanchi?
The appellant attempt to cause a miscarriage, and the complainant was a divorcee. She was living with her father's house, in his father's house, and the appellant was a neighbor and has good terms with him. With her father. And he was a married man with children. A complainant gave promise to marry her, and as a result, sexual intercourse took place between them, and she became pregnant. And when she asked him to fulfill his promise, he denied and suggested to take some drugs to procure a miscarriage. And one night he brought her a bottle half full of red liquid and packet containing some powder. And after he left, she tasted the powder, and finding it salty, she spat it out, and she did not even try the liquid. And the following night, when the appellant came again and found that she has not taken either the powder or the liquid, he forced her to consume the same, but she raised the alarm and the appellant fled. Mm-hmm. Upon analysis, it was found that the powder has a sulfate of copper, but the amount was not ascertain, and the poison, no poison was detected in the liquid. And also, in the further medical evidence, suggests that copper sulfate has no direct action on the uterus and is also not harmful unless taken sufficiently large quantities, which may then induce abortion.
Very
the
good.
Man, the man, the appellant, argued that the complainant was an accomplice and she was willing to destroy the fetus but was afraid of the consequences to herself. And then the judge stated that the appellant cannot in the law be convicted of an attempt to cause a miscarriage because whatever he did was not an act done towards the commission of the offense, and also neither the liquid nor the powder being harmful, they could not have caused a miscarriage, and also the appellant's failure was not due to the factor independent of himself.
That's right. So that's good. That's very good. Now what we have here, that she was pregnant and he has tried to abort. So there's an offense causing miscarriage. It is an offense under IPC. In 1933 case. So in 1933, we did not have medical termination possible. And unless the abortion was to be done for saving the life of the woman, it was an offense. And it is a graver offense if it is done without the consent of the woman. So in this case, he said, oh, she was willing, but she objected, etc. So he's not committed the offense without the consent. She was consenting. So that also the judges did not agree to, that she was a consenting party. She was not an accomplice in the offense. So that is a minor point. The major point is that now he has given her something which he believes is sufficient to cause miscarriage. He gave that powder and the liquid to her. She did not drink it fully. So whether he has committed the offense of attempting to cause miscarriage. And in this case, the question is also, there are two questions involved. One, that he has given her some substance which she did not consume because she didn't like the taste. So that was one cause of failure of his attaining the consequence. The second cause of failure was that the substance he has actually procured was not capable of causing miscarriage. Whatever amount of that particular medicine he would have given, if given a sufficient quantity, she could have died. But this thing had no effect on the fetus. So what is he trying to do? He's not wanting to kill her. There's no intention to cause death or doing anything to cause death. So therefore, there was no attempt to commit murder. And also the quantity was nowhere near that she could have died of that. But if given in sufficient qualities, it could have. But that is not the question. It is all hypothetical. What is true is that he did give her some substance, but that substance did not have the capacity to cause miscarriage for which he's being charged. So the question is, has he done an act which is capable of causing miscarriage? In cases of, so how is it, how is it? And the judge said, no, he's not guilty of attempt to cause miscarriage. So why did the judge say so? And how do you distinguish the facts of Asghar Ali Pradhania from 30, from the illustration to 511, which says you thrust your hand, there's no jewel. You open the box, there's no jewel. You thrust your hand, there's no money. You open the jewel box, there's no jewel. But it said you are still liable. So in this case, there was the jewel, the pregnancy was still there. He has done an act. But the judges said the act itself is incapable of. So suppose you know that there is money in that pocket. And you say, oh, I have this extraordinary power, where will I do this and do a mantra and it will all come out. The money doesn't come out of your, no, you have done your mantra. Or you want to kill somebody. So you believe in voodoo magic, black magic. So you make a doll and you put needles in it and that person doesn't die. So you have done what you think was sufficient, but it's not sufficient to actually, by going by the human experience, it is not capable of killing. Similarly, if you do put voodoo, the same manner, when we said you put needles in the voodoo doll and this man dies, we do not hold him liable for murder because we do not believe that there is a direct connection of his act to the consequence. It is just a coincidence as far as law is concerned. So in this case also, if your act itself is incapable of causing the consequence expected, then the judges say this was impossible. But in that also, then we get into a lot of difficulty. So now think of other scenario, because we have had cases of in the category called impossible attempts. One is this category when my act itself was not capable of causing the consequence. So Asghari Ali Pradhania says that the act of giving the drug, that drug was not capable of causing the consequence, and therefore there was deficiency in your act itself. If the consequence did not happen because of the intervention of some other fact. So suppose he had given the drug which was capable of causing the abortion, but the victim said, no, no, I don't like the taste, I will not drink it. And he's forcing, and she then shouts and people come and stop him. In that case, he will be held liable for attempt, because the drug he was giving was sufficient to cause, he's administered it to her, but the consequence did not happen because of the action of the other party, not his own action. So this is a very fine distinction. Where the consequence is not possible to be caused because there was deficiency on your own part, on the part of the accused itself. So in case of theft examples, jewel box and the pickpocket, in both cases, there was no deficiency on part of the offender. The deficiency was outside his action. The consequence of theft, actual theft, did not happen because there was no money, there was no jewel. So in that case, the action, the consequence did not happen, not because of your action. It was an something else which intervened. So if you want to set a house on fire, you have, it's a thatched hut. Huh? Go back to our Monodin Venkalu's case. So you have, and they did. They set the, they lighted the match. And before they could throw it, because of puff of wind, it got extinguished. Whether the offense of theft has been attempt to arson, set the house on fire, has been committed, what would you say? In Venkalu's case, they lighted the match, and before they could throw it, it got extinguished because of puff of wind. At that stage, they will be held liable for attempt to arson, because it was an external element which prevented them to set the house on fire. So suppose he has lighted the fire and he did not expect anybody to be there, but then immediately the servants saw it and he shouted. So before he could throw, he shouted, and finding that there was another person, he blew onto the match. Then will he be liable for attempt to arson?
Yes, ma'am.
Why?
Because, ma'am, he had done the act of lighting the fire, that's enough.
Because he blew the, in this second example, who has blew the fire himself, but because of the intervention of the third party, because he saw somebody was watching him. So it is not that on his own volition he had stopped. He suppose started going with matchbox and with petrol, etc., to his house, reached that house. And then some good thought entered his mind and he left that place without doing anything further. He has done everything there, but the actual act required towards the commission of the offense, he has done preparation. He is walking with all his ammunition in everything what he needs to. But he changed his mind at the last moment. He will change his mind on his own. He is not guilty. But he changed his mind, or he was forced to change his mind because there were other people who intervened or who saw, and therefore he stopped. Then he has already, if he suppose goes there with all those stuff and find there are a lot of people there, he couldn't do the firing because there were so many people there. Will he be held liable for attempt to arson? What do you think?
You're breaking here.
No, in this case, because he's still at the state of preparation, is going there to do it. But for setting the house on fire, he has to done the act of doing something to set the house on fire. He has made preparation. He's got petrol. He's got a match. He's walked to that house. But after reaching there, they found there are a lot of people there. So he just returned back. So he has not even started doing the act towards commission of the offense. So what is the key to make a distinction? He stopped on his own, yes, but he stopped on his own without having started the action towards commission of the offense. So if he stops himself, so then he has changed his mind that I will not do it today, I'll come another day when there's no one. He has not given up his idea of setting the house on fire. But that day he has not done any act towards commission of the offense. So if he has not started the act, he's still at the stage of preparation. So you have to be very clear. So what we are understanding is, suppose a person starts, he wants to cause death by slow poisoning. So he gave the first dose of poison to this person. With that one dose, he will not die. It will be only after 15, 20 days of those slow pauses, poison, that this man is going to die. So he has given the first dose. He has crossed the stage of preparation. He has started the act towards commission of the offense. So there would be certain scenario where only one act is required. If you fire, you fired, you pull the trigger, but there was a defect in the pistol because of which it could not have fired. So then, whether it be an act of attempt or not, because the instrument itself was faulty.
Ma'am, he's not liable.
Ma'am, he would be liable.
He would be liable, ma'am.
So tell me. Yeah, so then Deepika has to say why is he not liable, and Sandhya and Jashi have to say why is he liable. Exceeded preparation. Yes, Sandhya?
The stage of preparation has already been committed and action was also taken. The time when he triggered.
Ma'am, the preparation itself was at default. I mean, in the preparation itself, he has not.
Yeah, so if you were to look at Azhar Ali Pradhania, so if your instrument itself was faulty, your poison was not poison, it was just a powdered sugar. So if your action, if you fired and this fellow ducked, then clearly it was an attempt. There's no two doubt about it. Or you fired and instead of killing A, whom you were aiming at, B came in between, he died. Is liable for causing murder to B, but attempt to murder for A, right? Because you have done the act which was required of you. But in case where your own pistol was, and so only one act was required, and you have done that act, but the pistol itself was faulty, then in those cases the judges are saying, they're applying the same principle, saying that even though you have done the penultimate act, but the instrument itself was faulty, so the fault was lying at your end and not intervention by the other party. So it becomes a little confusing at times because some judges seem to be saying one thing, some judges saying to be a different thing in the same scenario. As a lawyer, you need to understand there are certain principles which they apply. Similarly, remember when we were at what was the name of the case? Where there was the hanging and he beat up and then he hanged the body. What is the name of that case?
Palanigundan.
Palanigundan. So Palanigundan, what we learned was the test that judges are saying, should we apply the objective test or subjective test? So in comparison to Palanigundan, where the judges said, we will apply the subjective test, this man was not aware that she was dead. Applying the subjective test, he did not have knowledge that the woman was still alive. The judges did not hold him liable for murder. But compared to this, contrasted with Virsa Singh. In Virsa Singh, the judges said, we will not go by his subjective knowledge whether the act is sufficient in the ordinary course of nature to cause death or not. We will apply the objective test. So in Palani Gowdam, they applied, they absolved him from liability by reference to subjective knowledge. In relation to Virsa Singh, they laid down the principle that no, we will apply, we will impose liability by reference to objective test. So we have learned that there are two ways to determine whether liability is to be imposed or not. Whether in which case they will apply objective test, in which case they will apply subjective test, that may vary. So once, of course, in case of now murder cases, they have said that these are the objective tests, these are the subjective tests, and the matter gets over with that. So that is the final holding of that, the holding of the law. But here, now we are at a stage where we find that we have one called impossible attempts. Then we have a social danger theory. And a third one is the penitence. There is a possibility of repenting and changing your mind. So applying different tests, you can come to a different conclusion. So if you were to apply the penalty, so the one is the penultimate act. Have you committed the last act required of you? Then whether your act itself was incapable of causing the consequence. Then whether the social danger, I'll come back to social. So then the other one was that you have still the occasion to change your mind. So you have, suppose you started writing, forging a will, forging a document. So you brought the stamp paper, you're creating a forged document in the name of somebody else. So you started writing on it, but then midway, somehow for some reason you stopped writing it. A year later, that incomplete document is still found in your possession. Can you be held liable for attempt to forge a document? You have started writing, but you stopped for whatever reasons. We do not know what was the reason, but a year later also you have still not completed that document. The judge will say, no, they have changed their mind. So they might have been stopped for whatever reason, but they did not continue. So they've changed their mind, it will be seen only as preparation and not attempt, because there was occasion for you to change your mind, and the fact that for 1 year you did nothing, it means that you changed your mind. The social danger theory. So two examples. A man fires in the jungle on something he believes to be his enemy, but it turned out that it was a log of wood. He fired, the log of wood was hit by a bullet, but because of the log of wood, the death did not occur of the person you were intending to kill. Will you be held liable for the offense of attempt to commit murder?
Yes, ma'am, I think so. There's
both, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, so, no, but that's where the whole confusion started. The judges said, no. It was jungle, it was sunsan, there was nobody around. So there was no social danger. You know, compared to this one, the other scenario has been that there was a moving carriage on the main road. You fired at the carriage, but there was nobody inside the carriage. Will you be held liable? So there was no human being. There was a log of wood. Now here is a carriage on the main road and you have fired. The man is not there. So nobody was injured in that whole process. The judges said, here you will be liable for attempt to commit murder. So it causes a lot of confusion that in the jungle, you said, no, there was nobody there, and there was nobody there actually. And you are not liable. But when in the carriage, there was nobody, you are saying now they will be liable. So judges say that the panic that will be created when people fire in public. So even if there's nobody inside, other people will be alerted. So the possibility of social danger in terms of causing halabaloo, there would be a stampede. There might be the fear. There might be that injury might be caused to somebody else. So given the social danger, consequences of your action in public will say, you have committed the attempt to commit the offense of murder. So if there was a room and you fired at the corner where you found, you thought that the man was standing there, but it was only his clothes which was standing there. The judges again say, no, 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 you have committed the offense. Rishabh, you have a question?
Yes, ma'am. In that last to last scene, that dysfunctional of the gun, ma'am, in that he was liable or not, ma'am? I'm sorry, I didn't get that properly.
Yeah, no, at some point of time, they have been saying, because there has been here also a growth of the cases. So earlier they were saying, you have done your act. But then they've said that, no, if your act itself is incapable of causing the consequence, then you're not liable.
So but now we have moved on to action. And mens rea both were there in that. His part of action was...
Come back to us, Garali Pradhania. He has action, he has intention, he has done the act. But the judges say, no, he's not liable because the powder he gave was not capable of causing the miscarriage which he was attempting to do. Of course, no, there's a lot of criticism in this case because the substance was not completely harmless. It could have caused harm. But the judges have taken the position that even if the harm could have been caused with that, that harm could have been at the death of the woman concerned. Any amount of what was the Deepika? What was the substance?
Copper sulfate, I think.
No, copper sulfate.
Sorry, ma'am.
What was the substance which was offered was copper sulfate. She said, yes, any quantity of copper sulfate would not cause abortion. And he is charged not for attempt to murder, he is charged for attempt to cause miscarriage. So any amount of copper sulfate, so if you were to, Rishabh, go by this argument, that he has done the act, he has the intention, but the consequences hadn't happened, then Asghar Ali Pradhania conviction should have happened, but it did not happen. And it did not happen on the ground that your act itself was incapable of causing the harm you are intending to. Of course, this is not known to you. Subjectively, you were wanting to do it. Objectively, it was not capable of doing it. So you can see that, you know, how this whole thing about subjective and objective are playing out. They're playing out in different manners. Here also, the judges are saying, objectively speaking, copper sulfate could not have caused miscarriage. So even though he has done the act itself is incapable of causing the death. And he did not know that this will not cause death. But the fact that he did not know is not relevant.
Okay.
So what we are now finding that there's a play of various tests that we've been thinking about, we've been learning about. So here, objectively, the action, you have done the action and you have the intention to cause the consequences. So subjectively, you were on the job, but objectively, you were not on the job. So some people do criticize that why should we go objectively? We should go by his objective knowledge. But then we do know that this objective-subjective tests have not been applied similarly in all cases. In murder, Virsa Singhvi said, no, 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 this will be your objective knowledge because of the liability will come. Here we are saying by objective knowledge, your liability will not come. So in case of Palani Gowden, objective knowledge, liability did not come. In murder, objective knowledge, liability did not come. In case of murder, objective knowledge, liability will come. So what we are learning here is that there is this focus. We have to, as a lawyer, you may have a look at what is the objective knowledge, what is the subjective knowledge, and can you build up an argument in favor of your client by reference to that test, by reference to saying interpretation should be coming here. So Banshika has written, having no knowledge of such an act being incapable is not taken into account. If the accused believes such an act to cause the harm that he was intending to inflict, will he still be absolved of liability of attempt? Yes, Vanshika, that's what we are coming to in this case. This question was not answered in yes in case of Virsa Singh. There we said, your knowledge is not relevant. That you did not know my act is capable of causing death is not relevant. We will look objectively whether your act was sufficient to cause death or not. So there, this person's knowledge was not relevant. But both in Palani Gaundan and in Aswarari Pradhania, we are saying it is not your knowledge. It is, objectively speaking, is your act capable of causing? In Palani Gaundan, they said your subjective knowledge is absolving you from liability. That he did not know that the woman was dead. So in Palani Gaundan, this is what happened. In Virsa Singh, the judges said, we will not look at your subjective knowledge, whether you knew it or not, that the act was sufficient to cause death. We will look at your objectively, and objectively, if your act was capable of imposing, of causing death, whether you knew it or not, whether you intended to cause death or not, we will still impose your liability. Now we have come to Askarali Pradhania, where the judges are saying, subjectively speaking, you thought you are committing the offense, but we will not hold you liable by your subjective knowledge. We will hold you liable or not liable by reference to objective knowledge. Because your act itself is not sufficient. Attempt is when you do an act which is capable of causing the consequence. You have started doing an act which can cause the consequences. So even if you get 10 times this amount, you would have still not caused miscarriage. So you thought that you were on the job, but objectively we know you are not on the job. So this is kind of really ridiculous that he is doing an act, but we are saying, no, you will not be held liable. And that is where a lot of confusion happened. It doesn't seem like common sense that if he's doing the act, why should he not be held liable? But this is what Asghar Ali Pradhania tells us, and a lot of other cases where they say, suppose he administered something to cause death. And he thought this is arsenic. So he gives arsenic. Now he has gone to the chemist, procured arsenic. Of course, he must have given him some reason. He gives him arsenic. But it turns out that what he thought was arsenic was actually pure sugar only. The judges say, no, you are not liable for attempt to commit murder. Because you are still not on the job, though you thought you were on the job. So the judges have made that argument. So in cases of all these categories of, when you're firing at the log in a jungle, the judges say it's isolated, nobody is supposed to be there, and there was actually nobody. You thought you were on the job, but you're not on the job, and therefore no liability. But if it is public place, it can cause social alarm. It can cause some danger to somebody else. So even if you did not actually injure somebody, anybody, but you've done the act which was capable of causing harm, even though the person intended to be harmed wasn't there, even though nobody else has been injured, but your action, because it is done in a public place where people are expected to be there. We are not even asking whether there were actually people there or not. But the fact that there was a possibility, there was a circumstance where they're expected to be people. So therefore, the social alarm it will cause will make you held liable. So we have found that there are four tests the judges are applying in reaching to the consequences. And if you apply a different, if you are able to convince the judge that this is not the test you should apply, this is the test you should apply, maybe you will succeed in getting the liability or getting out of the liability. So what are the four tests? One is the penultimate act. You have actually done the last act required. Then the second test is that you have committed impossible attempt, where your act itself is not capable of causing the consequence. The third one is, there is still possibility of you changing your mind and not committing the offense. The fourth one is social danger. That if it is likely to result in social danger, social alarm, some perception of fear, then you are still liable, even though your act was not capable of causing the, your act was. But it was impossible because of the circumstance because the object of your thing wasn't there. So that causes confusion in relation to the two illustrations we have. So therefore, the judges have again now built up this new category of saying social danger. Because when you say pickpocket, when you say jewel, these are examples which are not isolated category. These are kind of, if somebody puts a hand in your pocket, will you be alarmed whether you had any money or not?
Yes, ma'am, we'd be alarmed.
You will be alarmed. So therefore, it is irrespective of. So suppose you had, you know, he was thinking that you would have $10,000 in your pocket, but actually you have only 1,000. Doesn't make a difference. It is not the amount of. So suppose somebody you have no idea that you had any money in your pocket. You gave your trousers for washing. And the washerman found this whole lot of money in your pocket. So he keeps the money. You're not aware that your money has been stolen. Whether this man has taken your money can be held liable for the offense of theft. You're not read her, but just common sense. Do you think the offense of theft has been committed?
Yes, ma'am.
It is no. Committed, even though, Shubham, you're saying no. Why do you say no? No. Your 10,000 are gone.
Ma'am, because the washerman has not retaken the money out of his possession.
When you gave your trouser, have you parted with your possession of the property? He's not supposed to bring it back to you.
He's still the owner, no?
You're still the owner.
Yeah.
So he has got a physical custody, but you have the constructive custody of your trouser. So whatever is in your trouser is in your custody, even though you're not aware of it.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So when you say possession, you have constructive possession over your trousers. So you have constructive possession not only of your trousers, but everything which was in the pocket also. So the only point I'm making by this example is that your objective knowledge was that there's nothing in the pocket, but subjectively there is money. Again, you are saying the play of the objective-subjective instances. So it is not that because objectively speaking, you did not know your money, he doesn't commit the offense. He still commits the offense. So you will say constantly that the usage by, you know, in which the objective-subjective tests have been done is very different. It varies from circumstance. There's no one principle that we will apply only objective knowledge in all cases. Or we will apply only subjective knowledge in all cases. We have applied different tests in different circumstances. And in case of attempt, because of these four different tests applied in different circumstances, the case law becomes very confusing. You will find in one case they are saying liability, in other case they say no liability. And you get very confused as a scholar, as a person reading the cases. It becomes very, very confusing. So the only way to understand the offense of attempt is to decide, to kind of know that what are the range of tests which the judges have applied in order to understand why the judgment has come in this way. And that gives you a tool in your hands as a lawyer to say, okay, let me see which is the test which may be applied in the facts of this case and which will be beneficial to my client. If you are the state counsel, then you would want to have conviction and you will argue on the basis of the test which will lead to conviction. The other side will try to say that no, this test should be applied by reference to which he gets acquittal. And whichever side is able to convince the judge what is the appropriate test to apply in the facts may succeed. So with those facts, when you come back to Asghar Ali Pradhania again, there's something that we should read in Asghar Ali Pradhania, some paras. Look at the second page in the case. after R versus McPherson, Chief Justice Cockburn held that the conviction was wrong because the word attempt clearly conveys with it the idea that if the attempt had succeeded, the offense charge would have been committed. The prisoner was charged with breaking and entering the prosecutor's house and stealing therein contained specific chattels and was convicted of attempt to steal those chattels. Unknown to him, those chattels had been stolen already. So there the judge is saying that no, by his act, he could not have succeeded in his offense and therefore there was a fault on his part. There is no doubt a difference between the preparation antecedent to an offense and the actual attempt. But if the actual transaction had commenced, which would have ended in the crime if not interrupted, there is clearly an attempt to commit the crime. Then at the bottom of this case, an attempt to commit a crime is an act done with intent to commit that crime and forming part of a series of acts which would constitute its actual commission if it were not interrupted. To put the matter differently, attempt is an act done in part execution of a criminal design, amounting to more than mere preparation, but falling short of actual consummation and possessing, except for failure to consummate, all the elements of substantive crime. In other words, attempt consists in the intent to commit a crime combined with the doing of some act adapted to but falling short of its actual commission. It may consequently be defined as that which is not prevented, which, if not prevented, would have resulted in the full consumption of the act, consummation of the act attempted. Now look at the bottom of this page again. So far as the law in India is concerned, it is beyond dispute that there are four stages in every crime: the intention to commit, the preparation to commit, the attempt to commit, and if the attempt is successful, third stage is successful, the commission itself. Intention alone or intention followed by preparation are not sufficient to constitute an assent to an attempt. But intention followed by preparation, followed by an act toward the commission of the offense, is sufficient. Acts done toward the commission of the offense are the vital words in this connection. So then they give the example of the witchcraft, puts a spell. We say this is not an act toward the commission of the offense because his failure to cause hurt is due to his own act or omission. The act was intrinsically useless or defective or inappropriate for the purpose he had in mind, owing to the undeveloped state of his intelligence or to ignorance of modern science. His failure was due, broadly speaking, to his own volition. So this is what the test is. Then the judges further say, if A, with intent to hurt B by administering poison, prepares a glass for him and fills it with poison, but while A's back is turned, she has observed A's act, he empties the poison and fills the glass with water, which A, in ignorance of what she has done, offers it to B. Now B drinks that water. Whether the offense is committed or not committed, an offense to commit murder.
No, ma'am.
Why?
Because it was the intervention of the third party and not on his own volition. It was.
Now look, let's see what the judges are saying. In my opinion, A is guilty and can be convicted of an attempt to cause hurt by administering poison. His failure was not due to any act or omission of his own, but to the intervention of a factor independent of his own volition. This important distinction is correctly stated by Justice Turner in Ram Charan's case, where he observed that to constitute an attempt, there must be an act with the intention of committing an offence, and in attempting the commission, in each of the illustrations in section 5 and 11, we find an act done with the intention of committing an offence and immediately enabling the commission of the offence, although it was not an act which constituted a part of the offence, and in which we find the intention of the person making the attempt was frustrated by circumstances independent of his volition. In Empress versus Ganesh, it was said that some external act, something tangible and ostensible, of which the law can take hold as an act showing progress towards the actual commission of the offence, is necessary to constitute the offence. It does not matter that the progress was interrupted. Then Russell also says here, it is an act directly approximating to or immediately connected with the commission of the offence, which the person doing it has in view. So when the, so in case of somebody else changing the poison, he did not succeed, not because of his own volition, but because of somebody else. So now tell me, if a man puts poison in a glass, he puts on the table where he knows B will come and take his, take, we will drink this water. And after that, he goes off. The man comes, and as he was about to take that glass of poison, a cat jumped, and because of which the water is spilled. The cat drinks that water and dies. Whether the man who has put the glass with poison is liable?
Yes, ma'am.
Why?
Yes, ma'am.
Because he did not stop by his own volition. It was the third party, that is the cat, which avoided the him to drink the glass.
So can we argue that he died? No, suppose he picks up the glass and consumes the poisoned water. Will he be liable for attempt, for the offense of murder? Or maybe he kind of, so the point I was asking was, can we say that but for the act of B picking up the glass, he would not have died? So till the time B picks up the glass, the action, the consequence could not have occurred. What I did was, I was solely preparing. So the actual act toward commission would be when he picks up the glass. If I give it directly to him, I've not given it to him, I've just kept it at a place.
Ma'am,
so am I in the stage of preparation or I've attempted?
In case of Mashnuru, they talked about Aristotle's theory of acts. So they said like there are four types of acts, but there is one which is the most important in the commission of the act. And I think putting the poison in the glass and keeping it on the table was the most significant act and not picking
most
up.
Efficient. Very good, Satyam. Very good. So he has done the most efficient act, the consequence of which would have been death. So picking up the glass and drinking it would have been only instrumental. But that is not substantive. You can pick up a glass of water and don't die. So that act is not relevant, is not important at all for the consequences. The consequences would have come from the mixing of the poison. So that argument was taken in the discourse of children also, that no, they consume it themselves. But that did not absolve them from the liability. So similarly here, the most efficient cause you have prepared. So you mix poison, but it turns out that what you are mixing was only sugar. You thought it was poison, but you have mixed sugar. Now this man comes and picks up and doesn't die. Can you be held liable for murder?
No, ma'am.
Yeah, because the most efficient cause is missing. You have not done the most efficient cause. You should have done something which constitutes the most efficient cause. So then that was very good input.
Ma'am, can I ask a question before we proceed?
Yes, please.
Ma'am, suppose I am intending to kill a person and finding that person sleeping in their room, I go and behead them. But like after the postmortem report comes, it is found that they had died 20 minutes prior to the beheading and because of a heart attack. Mm-hmm. So in that case, can I be held liable for attempt to murder?
What will be the arguments for and against? Let's work on that. What are the possible arguments for saying yes, it was attempt to murder? What will be the arguments against it?
I'm saying support, it could be that had they been alive, everything else was committed that could have, that would have caused death. So in 307, it is said that if it would have successfully happened, it would have resulted into death. So except for this condition that they were dead, death would have occurred. So I think that brings it in a 307 in my opinion.
So what will be the counter argument?
The counter would be that the element that requires every, for every criminal act, that the person should be capable of receiving
being killed, being killed,
yes, and an act being committed. So that is missing. So it should not be considered an attempt to murder. Or for that,
you know your answer. You know your answer.
Ma'am, but if we slightly change the situation, suppose this is happening in the middle of a street and two people fire at a person at the same time, but later it is found that before the second bullet hit the person, the first bullet had already killed him. So in this case, are we not going to impose the social danger theory that we are doing this in the middle of the road, and although the person died a second prior to my firing at him, it could still constitute an attempt to murder?
I think it's very much open to argue one way or the other. It will be open to argue to say that no, because the man was no more alive, so I've caused social danger, so I've caused panic, I've caused rampage. So then you charge me for those offenses, because in order to cause death, I should be causing death of somebody alive. So by my action, I could not have caused death. And therefore, if I could not have caused death, I could not have caused attempt to cause death, attempt to commit murder. So if by my action, I could, suppose by my action, I could not have caused murder, I could not have caused death, then how can I be held liable for attempt to cause death? Attempt to, not to cause death, cause death is not the offense. Offense is attempt to commit murder. So if I cannot be, because the test is that will by that action, if completed, would I have been liable for murder? So if I would not be liable for murder, I can, how can I be liable for attempt to commit murder? If the act uninterrupted could have caused death is our test. So that is our test. Then even if he was alive, then I could have caused his death. But the fact that there was no living human being, I could not have caused death. We are caught in that bind.
Yes,
that, we are back to the same thing, that if the man is, you know, the woman was not alive, but he thought the woman was alive, he thought she was dead. You know, so judges have given benefit even in that scenario because of his belief. So whether reverse, that his belief is he's alive, but then we are stuck with that he believe impossible attempts, no? Where we say that your act is not capable of, either intrinsically because of your own actions or because of the circumstances surrounding it. So in this case, you know, there is a sentence here, I'll find that out in one of these cases, where the judges do use this other word, that because of the external circumstances, because of which you could not have done that act, then you're not liable for the offense.
Ma'am, let's suppose I kept the poison and at that time the person was alive. But after me keeping the poison on the table, someone else killed that person and they could never drink the poison from the glass. In this case, the most efficient act has been committed, but because of the interference from a third party, the person never got to drink the poison. So in this case, an attempt would constitute.
When you look at, because I have done the last act which was required of me. He did not drink it because he died before that. So I think it becomes an instance of impossible attempt. No, I did not know that he has died in the night before And I thought tomorrow morning he gets up every day and he drinks water before he goes and does anything else. It is his habit. So he put the poisoned water in the morning. So in the morning he never woke up. So will I be held liable? It's very tricky. I do not know. I would want. Good question. So what do the others think?
Ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, in this scenario, I feel that he would be liable because if we go to the definition of 307, it specifically talks about if he by that act caused death. So the specification of he, I mean, from whoever to he, specifically means that the subjective knowledge of that person is something that is coming into play. And he has done that act by which he could have caused death. Now, whether the act was, whether he was dead or not, coming to the objective theory, ma'am, the issue that I have with it is that if we are looking at it with a purely objective theory, then in a way we are not considering mens rea to that importance that it should be considered. So in a subjective theory, we are looking at mens rea and actus rea, I feel, in a proper sense, and that is why I feel in this case he would be liable, because if he by that act caused death.
No, but tell me, he thinks that this man is alive, this is a dead man. So he just died, he's stolen this, his body is still not, what do you call that, you know, that mortis, you know, where the body becomes stiff, that state has still not come, rigor mortis has still not set in. So he opens the mouth of the dead man and pours the poison. I don't think he can be held liable, even if he pours the poison in his mouth. The man is already dead. So I would certainly, if I was the lawyer, I would certainly insist on this aspect, not more. But I'm quite sure it's possible to argue both ways. But I would think that if I was the lawyer, I would argue on the saying that no, it was not possible to cause death because the man is already dead. So if I put the poison before he died, yeah, so I put it at night when he was still alive and he was expected to get up in the morning. So I would want to make a distinction between when was the act being done.
Ma'am, if both these acts are happening simultaneously, that he being killed by the other and he is placing the poison on the table, then he will be held liable, I think. Because the
judge
person
will
is
argue. We'll argue and wait for the judge to give a judgment. I'm not teacher, I'm not the judge. So I do not know. But I think, no, for me, what I'm teaching you is that if you are a lawyer, what will you argue on this side? If you were the lawyer on the other side, what will you argue? This is what your job is. You become a judge, then you have to decide on the facts and circumstances, the details of it, that what will you apply. And I'm quite sure that in this case, judges will differ. You might have a minority-majority judgments also. Because these are so nuanced scenarios at this point of time, that unless we know the other, no, I'm not talking even of the question of evidence. We are assuming that this all has been proved, that Simon Disney, when he put the poison drink, somebody went inside and shot him dead. We are assuming that both these facts, that this is exactly the same time which has happened. It's very difficult to have a principle by reference which we can say, will he be held liable or not? But I think the fact that this person died because of the act of somebody else, and you had no occasion, there was no possibility of your act being carried forward. This is what I will argue. But whether the judges will agree with it or not, I do not know.
Ma'am, just one more question.
Yes, Ayush.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, so can we argue this in the way that the objective of making the IPC was to punish certain offenses against the society? Now, these certain offenses have been classified into murder and attempt to murder. Now, if, for example, because of this act, the person had died, then it would obviously had been murder. The objective of making Section 307 was to punish the attempts of this kind. And that is why this attempt should be, because it's more about the person doing that. Yes, ma'am.
That argument will apply to all cases. Then there will be no case. Then there will be nothing called Asghar Ali Pathania would not happen then. Because Asghar Ali Pathania was saying there is a circumstance where you did everything for commission of the offense. It was said, no, he will not be held liable. So that argument is well made, that because we want to prevent people. The whole idea of criminal law has been based on retribution and deterrence. That by punishing the offender or punishing people who are trying to commit offenses, you are dissuading people to attempt even. We are not saying you will be punished only when you commit the offense. So, going by the objective of criminal law, we will make that argument. But then we have also said that you want to punish people for the actual harm caused or the possibility of harm. So in this case, if we say that the possibility of harm wasn't there because the man has died, therefore it will be very difficult. Money. So it becomes very difficult to argue by reference to that, that if the purpose was to prevent harm in this case, no harm could have been prevented. Then if you are able to convince the judge in that scenario. So I think, suppose this kind of question comes to you in an exam, then you have to give this both back and forth. You have to say that, you know, these are the possible arguments, and depending on other circumstances which may impact the decision may be for or against. You don't have to necessarily give a decision. Most of the time, so you have two levels of your testing. One is the examination, the other is the actual course. In the actual courts, the judges will decide whether they're convinced by your arguments or not. In the examination, very exceptionally, we say whether there'll be liability or not. We do ask that question very frequently, whether liability or not, but you don't have to necessarily give one answer only that he will be liable or he will not be liable. You can say, if we take this argument, he will be liable. If you take this argument, he's not liable. And it is not very clear, more detailed facts are not there. And therefore, depending on other facts, whether there was any difference in the timing, all those kinds of things may be raised for you for you to convey that you understand the nuance of the circumstance. So for me, I will want to use these knowledges I have acquired from the other areas. This objective knowledge, social danger, and the impossibility of attempt, all these arguments I will put forward to then argue that by reference to this test, the liability will not come, or by reference to this test, liability may come. I think that's a very good answer if you're able to do that. So shall we look at the second case? Abhyan and Mishra? No, Om Prakash, which is the second case?
Abhyan and Mishra.
Abhyan and Mishra. Very, very pertinent to you people. Students trying to cheat. So what are the facts, Abhyan and Mishra? Remembering Ayush's request last time, do you want to take a 5-minute break?
Yes, ma'am, that would be...
Yeah, because I think we should be kind of completing this topic today, apart from attempt to commit suicide, which will take up tomorrow. So if we need to extend this time, we will do that. So I'll stop recording, then I'll start again. So we'll have 2 separate sessions for today. So take a 5-minute break, and 5 minutes means 5 minutes. In that 5 minutes, you can brush up. If you have not looked at Abhyan and Mishra and Om Prakash and Yakub, do that.